everyone.
I am Jason Verlini, the publisher of the Fretboard Journal, which we publish 10 miles that way in Ballard. And in every issue, we try to feature amazing, beautiful vintage instruments and amazing world-class musicians. And today, we have both of those here. Many of these instruments have actually been in the Fretboard Journal. Some will soon be. And both of these guys, Chris Eldridge and Julian Lodge, have been in the Fretboard Journal and will probably be many times over in the future because we love them. And the story here is we did something similar last year with David Grisman and Kenny Smith and had such a great time. We wanted to do it again with another set of musicians. So thanks to our readers and thanks to the Seattle music community and everyone who's come to Wintergrass, we've found all of these amazing vintage guitars. We've got two Gibson L5s. We've got consecutive serial number Washburns that were in the magazine. Gibson Roy Smeks, vintage Martins, couple of Henderson guitars, one built by his daughter Jane, one built by Wayne a couple years ago. And we're just gonna play fly on the wall and pretend that we're in the world's greatest guitar store. And we happen to stumble on Critter and Julian walking through a bunch of cool guitars, and they're gonna put them through their paces and maybe tell us a little bit about what they think and have fun. So thanks everybody.
Well, this is super fun. I love the idea that we are in a guitar store, because this is basically what Julian and I do when we go into guitar stores.
Pretty much. Exactly.
Pick them up and do this. This is a cool old guitar. I'm super not. Yeah, imagine that. I'm not super knowledgeable about these, but this is a Maurer, 1929 Maurer, and they were built, I believe, by the Larson brothers. Is that correct? It's a Larson guitar, and it's really cool. I haven't played many Larsons in my day, but they're, they were like one of the great builders back in that era. This one's from 1929, and
it's great. What do you feel is the difference between Larson's and my guitar? Because I hear a big difference. And just how the sound kind of comes out.
Yeah, it's very.
Larson's to me always feel kind of boxy in a really elegant way.
Yeah.
You know, the sound just kind of like. Old L5s do, they just kind of, every note pops out in a certain. What's that, Eddie Lang song? Could I hit that any harder? God.
This like harmonic structure that's very clear.
Yeah.
I'm hearing that. Yeah, that's a lot more. Yeah, it's like an arch top.
It's like an arch top. Very peculiar. And they're both rosewood, huh?
Yeah.
This one, yeah, we didn't talk. That's an 1885 Martin Singolo 28.
No big deals.
Not a big deal.
Shall we move along?
So pretty. Okay, this goes to you. What should we play next, dude?
We didn't really have a game plan.
Both rosewood? Yeah, these are consecutive serial number Washburns.
Actually, here, you know what? Play that one. Because these are consecutive serial numbers, I want to see, we'll have a control here.
Okay,
now
what
play
I
this
play?
One.
Play something again and then
play
that?
Play, yeah,
okay.
Play this one.
What's the difference? What do you hear? Is that right? It's quieter to me. But as the player, you get less back from it. Yeah, it's a way thinner feeling.
Yeah, it's a little boxier. Almost more, it sounds more larceny.
That one sounds more like. Isn't that funny? So this sounds quieter.
Yeah.
Far out. Because.
It's interesting. This one has a lot less low end,
maybe that's
which tends to project back more, in my experience,
yeah.
The person playing the guitar will often hear a sort of low end that doesn't propagate out as much out front.
That's so true. That's true.
So yeah, it might sound louder to us.
Okay.
But yeah.
Okay.
Anyway.
This is great.
Yeah, what should we do?
Do you want to play another fiddle type tune, or do you want to play one of ours?
Let's play one of ours on this. My guess is they're the same strings, but even strings can't account for that much difference. That's definitely the difference of these two guitars. And it's interesting, I mean, they're consecutive serial numbers, so chances, you know, are that you're using a lot of the same pieces of wood. But a lot of times consecutive serial number guitars will sound very similar. They'll sound like brothers compared to like D28s. You know, if you have like two that are right next to each other, they often sound similar. More so than another D28, even from the same year, but maybe a different time. But also it just goes to show that these things are made of like organic materials and they're put together by humans. And they're all these subtle differences that even if you have two that are theoretically the same, they're not, you know?
I don't think I've ever played two consecutive serial numbers of anything.
Yeah. Chris Thiele has, he has two consecutive serial number lores, which are very different.
Yeah.
And actually we know the third one. John Paul Jones has the first of the three consecutive serial numbers, which is the most incredible mandolin ever heard. But yeah, it's pretty cool to hear them together.
What about for credit?
Yeah, let's do that.
I think that would sound
yeah.
good. Jason, I've been reading the article about Washburn's in the new issue. It's so good. I've actually been on a mission to try to find one that I could afford. So I'll just take this.
Yeah. That's what
I'll take this as a sign. Sorry.
Thank you.
37.
Yeah.
I've had left hand troubles for the last couple of years, just from years of kind of playing like an idiot. But it happens. But I've avoided necks of this stature.
Also,
you want to trade?
Sure.
Yeah.
I'll take it where I can get it. Thank you for.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. Thank you. No, it's really funny. I mean, I feel so blessed, very lucky, because as a kid, I grew up in Northern California, basically down the road from David Grisman. And I think I met him when I was about 9 or 10, and we started playing together, and he would just send me home with really cool old guitars. I remember having a 24 L5 signed by Lohr. I was about 11. I had that for like a summer. I just would practice on it. I had no idea what I had on my hands. And then I had an early 50s D18 for a while. That was beautiful. I had a Gilchrist archtop, two of them for a while.
Really?
Yeah, those were great. And I scratched it. I still feel guilty. But I was so fortunate. So my whole life, and just further down the road where I'm from is Schoenberg Guitars, Eric Schoenberg. And so I would spend the weekends there. My dad and I would go and just play all the guitars. So much of the reason I love guitar is wrapped up in vintage instruments. That's hugely part of it. And I just kind of played everything exactly the same, you know, with the same touch and approach for so many years. And then a couple years ago, my hands just started not working so well. And just... I won't bore you with it, but it's made me really appreciate the ability to play vintage instruments, and I don't take it for granted. I think I took it for granted, but I don't anymore. So this means a lot to me.
Slow and mellow.
This
one, like whiskey before breakfast or something.
Sure.
Like that.
Thank you. fun to play because it seems like the quieter you play, the richer the sound is. At least from the player's perspective. This is a good living room guitar.
All have these huge, wide necks.
Yours as well.
Yeah.
He does that really well, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe we should have done something like that.
I don't know. This one's a 37. What's yours?
This is a 36.
I'm a little younger.
Royce
Mech. Royce
Mech.
Does anyone know how many models Royce Mech had in his lifetime? Because he was with every builder.
Harmony.
He had the Harmony.
Yeah.
He had these. Did he have anything else? He had Hughes, right?
Oh,
Lap Steels. He had Lap Steels? Gibson L5. It says the earliest L5 ordered with banjo tuners purchased in Canada. Yeah, that's so unusual to have these kind of tuners on here.
This is a 1938 L5. And it was apparently formerly owned by Frankie Remley, I think that says, who was Jack Benny's band leader.
So it's a funny guitar.
Yeah.
What should we play?
Yeah, do we? God, maybe I'll do a soul thing on this eventually.
Yeah.
Big stand. It would, but he doesn't play on it. He's got to play guitar.
That's okay. I'll stand here and this thing will make anybody look good.
Rule number one about archtops. No. We need help. We need all the help we can get.
There's a somebody I'm longing to see. I hope that she turns out to be someone who I drove her You tell her, please, to put on some speed. Follow my lead. Oh, how I need someone to watch over me. Could we try Meeting House?
Of course.
Yeah, all right. We're gonna play one of ours that usually, it's for me, it's just kind of an experiment because it kind of relies on the sustainy nature, I think, of our Martins and how they kind of play together. But I think this will be interesting. It may or may not work, yeah. but I'm curious to see. Thank you.
sound of kind of overdriving an arch top. It's kind of like distortion. Different.
I kind of want to hear you play this thing.
Okay.
For those guitar players out there, you know this, but a good trick to learn how to play acoustic arch tops. I played one. I have a 32 Gibson L5 that I love. That's by a lot of guitar purists considered kind of a different era than this, even though it's still 16 inches, but just it's different. They're different guitars. But the best way to practice, in my experience, is in just kind of into the corner of a room, stand really close to it, because unlike flat tops, you can't hear yourself that well with arch tops. All the sound is just funneled out in this very specific way, so that's helped me a lot practicing in corners by myself. It hasn't helped my social life, but I feel confident playing
this, arch tops. This guitar, by the way, is incredible. Just if anybody's wondering. Wow. Unless you wanted to play it on this one.
A little bit.
Here, well, you should. That thing's great too. Thank you.
that right?
Yeah.
Okay, deal. If you have any questions out there, I'm not sure we can answer them, but experientially speaking, we can tell you what it feels like. If anyone has it. We've been, Critter, when did we meet? Is it 6 years ago? Something like that?
Yeah.
About 6 years we've known each other, and we've threatened to play together in a proper setting all that time. It's only been about 2 years, year and a half, 2 years that we've actually been playing as a band. This is a band. Constitutes a band. Yeah.
Is that old Sunburst L5? Is it smaller than the other one?
It's a 16-inch arch across the lower bout, the bigger bout. Whereas the blonde one is 17, I believe. 25 for the Sunburst, and is it
38
for the big one. So different. They're such different guitars. It's crazy. The Sunburst is closer to a flat top, in my opinion. Very subtle arch. It's a pretty wild experience. Yeah. What's the difference?
Well, I just wanted to see how close these two were to being brothers. I'm just curious. This is 36.
That's a great D18. And I think I played this guitar years ago at, I believe it was Grass Valley. And it is just as awesome now as it was then. Myself. Thank you. I've been hanging out uptown, loading that low down rain, watching Good Time Charlie friends, is it driving me insane? Up on shady Charlotte Street, though the green lights look red, wish I was back home on the farm, loading in my feather bed. And I got myself a rocking chair to see if I could lose East End I'm hard time in a long Church Street blues. Paper friend, read yesterday's news, folded up page 21 and stuck it in my shoes. Gave me a nickel to the poor, my good turn for the day, folded up my old billfold and I threw it far away. And I got myself a rocking chair to see if I could lose East End I'm hard time to have on Church Street blues. Guitar strings, old black diamond brand, I string up this old Martin box and I go and join some band. But I guess I'd better sit right here and pick and sing a while, try to make me a little change and give you folks a smile. And I got myself a rocking chair to see if I could lose East End I'm hard time to have on Church Street blues. And I got myself a rocking chair to see if I could lose East End I'm hard time to have on Church Street blues.
Thank you.
guitar is really cool. That's an insane instrument. This one is 76 serial numbers away from Charles Sawtelle's old D28, which I had the great privilege of caretaking for a few years back. Which is the serial number on Charles's guitar is 68500, and this one is 68424. And it's interesting. There is a thing to the batches. We were saying something about that earlier, like consecutive serial numbers. Like there's some characteristics that I probably can't actually put into words, but you'll just have to trust me that it's there because they're close. There's some really unique characteristics that I think of when I think of Charles's guitar that are in this guitar. It's cool how, I don't know if that was just the guys that they had working at the factory then or the pieces of wood or what, but it's neat how they kind of clump together.
I kind of hear it. Mm-hmm. I knew that guitar a little bit, obviously not as well as you, but I kind of hear it.
Yeah.
The way you activate it. So.
Yeah. Well, onward?
Onward.
All right. Such a selfish exercise.
We're glad we're part of it.
Is good. That right?
We are too.
What was the name of that last one?
Yeah. Well, you tell our moms, don't tell our girlfriends.
That's too much.
What was that last tune?
That's called Old Grimes, which I learned from Jesse Cobb, my old bandmate in the String Dusters.
I'm dying to play this.
Yeah.
So what is this? This is a 1939 Gibson Advanced Jumbo. So as I understand, it's kind of like a J35, J45 with rosewood instead of mahogany.
Let me hear what that thing sounds like.
Scale, isn't it? Is that right? AJ is a long scale version of it? Or are they all long? Nothing's this feels longer. Maybe I got smaller. Self-tuning was invented, apparently, around 1939. Okay. It's just my luck. You want to sing something? Or like, Keep Me From Blowing Away, or?
Yeah, maybe that's good. Yeah.
I feel like that's conducive.
Away. Yeah. Oh, sorry. This is a 1936 D28. Serial number 62556, and it's in just beautiful shape, and it, sound kind of speaks for itself.
Peter, what do you think? I know we've talked about it, but it might be interesting to talk about it with them. What do you think defines a great dreadnought? When is it really great versus just that's fine?
My favorite dreadnoughts are guitar. They don't have the voices of a dreadnought. Hmm. They're not the big, uber powerful dreadnoughts. They're voiced. This is just my personal preference. But to me, the ones I love the most are kind of voiced more like a small body guitar, more like maybe a 000 OM kind of thing, but they just have a little bit more power behind them. Yeah. But fundamentally, those are the ones I like. I like a dreadnought that's really even and responsive. And then you have a few like kind of weird mutants. Like there's a dreadnought I played. It used to belong to Norman Blake. I think he played it on, I'm not sure what record he played it on, but there's a cool like TV video thing you can find on YouTube of Norman playing this guitar. It's a 1934 solid peghead D28, 14 fret. And that is a dreadnought. And that's just about the best guitar. That's one of the great ones I've ever played. Huh. Yeah, and there's nothing small bodied about it. It's just it sounds angry all the time. But it works for that guitar. The other thing, just while I'm pontificating, I tend to like, rosewood guitars that sound like they're made of mahogany, and mahogany guitars that sound like they're made of rosewood. I think to me, always my favorite thing is it's never the platonic ideal of like a D18. I like a D18 that sounds like a D28, and vice versa. I feel like the truth always lives somewhere in between with all my favorite guitars.
Is that true for electrics too?
I just don't know enough about electrics.
Yeah, either do I.
Yeah.
I'd ask. Wow. Okay.
I spent my whole lifetime in a world where the sunshine found excuses for not hanging around. I've squandered emotions at the slightest of notions, at the first easy loving I found. But soon the good times, the gay times, the play times, like colors run together and fade. Oh Lord, if you hear me, touch me and hold me, keep me from going. Thank you.
questions or concerns you may have? Yeah.
This is a this is a 37 D28 I just picked up.
What am I playing?
That's a 36.
What is it?
To me, a scalloped, scalloped braced guitars are tend to be. Well, it's never universally true that that any kind of guitar is anything. You know, there are always exceptions. But in general, scalloped braced guitars tend to be a little bit more kind of lively in a certain way. I'd say there's just less. There's less mass on the braces, and so the top is allowed to move a little more freely. And so there might be just a trend of a little bit more of a deep sound, a little more low end. But there are plenty of 50s D28s that are super responsive and have plenty of growl in them, and plenty of, 1930 whatever D28s that don't. But
when did they stop scalloping?
I think they stopped scalloping in 44. Yeah.
44.
Yeah. Wow. But it was a steady evolution of what Martin was doing. You know, because for those of you who aren't like total guitar geeks, which at this point I'm sure I'm probably preaching to the choir. But underneath these tops, there are these bracing patterns, and Martin was kind of constantly tweaking them throughout, from like the kind of golden era of these things in the 30s, late 20s and early 30s, on through the, certainly through the 50s, just basically always modifying them, slow glacial changes, but there are always changes that essentially, it's like a different engine under the top. The way you brace the guitar kind of totally affects how it responds. So, I don't even know what I'm trying to say.
Why did they change it?
They started changing them, my understanding, initially, I'm a lot more knowledgeable about dreadnoughts than anything else, but on the dreadnoughts, the early ones, they had something, there's a large pair of braces here. They kind of go, they crisscross right around here, called the X-brace. And if you look in any old guitar, you can see, as you're sitting there playing it, you can see this brace coming across. It's just inside the sound hole. Anyway, the point at which they met is somewhere about right here. And Martin, back in those days, people played on, they used heavy gauge strings because there wasn't really amplification. And there's a tremendous amount of tension on a guitar anyway, but especially with these heavy gauge strings, it was pulling the bridges up. It was causing the tops to belly up. It wasn't sufficient to kind of stabilize the guitar. And Martin's had a lifetime repair guarantee to the original owner. If you bought the guitar, they would repair it for life. So this was very problematic because their guitars were starting to warp and deform, and they were having to repair them, and it cost them time and money. So in 1938, Martin shifted the X brace back a little further. You hear people talk about forward X and rear X. And they shifted this X brace back so it was a little closer to the bridge so it could support the bridge more, because that's where all this tension is kind of coming to a head here. And so that's like a real thing. When people talk about like the real golden era of Martin guitars, they're talking about forward braced, wide neck guitars. And then in 1939, I have a D28. My main guitar is it's kind of a weird transitional guitar. In 1939, Martin took their wide neck spacing and narrowed it down a little bit, added another brace here called a popsicle brace, and they thickened. There was already a cross brace that was there. They thickened that considerably. Certainly this stuff is all structural. The neck, I don't know why they changed that. But, there's this steady evolution of things. They abandoned the scalloped bracing in the 40s. I don't know, it's each era kind of has its own flavor. It's fun to kind of nerd out on.
Does anyone, I'm interested in this guy named John Dykel. Does anyone know about him? As I understand it, John Dykel was the luthier who worked at Martin, who invented the OM and the Dreadnought. And he had kind of a tragic story. He was married to this woman he was really in love with, and I think something happened. She passed away, and he just decided, he was really sad and committed his life to making, he devoted his life to guitar behavior, basically, and figuring out what would make the best, and he just had this laser-like focus, and yeah, he designed this shape and the OM, and Martin doesn't talk about him much, but if you go through the records, he's the guy, and I was wondering if any of you could tell me more about him. Dykeman, thank you. Okay, good. In the works. Oh. Is Woody writing it?
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. Sorry. That's good, because what a badass. Sure.
All right, we're going to play another one of our tunes.
Thank you.
Just sit up here and play these guitars.
Can we do one more and then
call it?
Yeah, I think. But you want to play ours?
Sure.
Yeah, we'll play. Julian and I have. I just got a new guitar. It's a 1937 D18, new to me anyway. And that's what I brought out here. And Julian has.
I have a 1939 00018. It's a smaller body mahogany.
Yeah, so we'll close it out. Yeah. Playing things we know how to play. Guys, thank you so much.
So
this
much
has really been kind of a fun thing for us to do. Proper show at 8. I'm not sure where. The Evergreen. Hello. Oh man, yeah. Yeah, by the way, yeah, big time thank you to Jason, Fretboard Journal, for putting this together. This is just what a cool thing to do.
This is 39.
That's Julian's main acoustic. I just got this guitar, and it has a. This is the first time we've really taken these two out and played them together. Because normally I play a D28, so it's a little bit more of a. It's got a darker, deeper sound. I always feel like it's sort of like a warm blanket for that guitar.
Yeah.
This one is a lot more similar. They have a lot more of a similar character to them.
It's a mahogany. It seems, yeah, I think I play better on mahogany guitars, I think. I kind of have a scrappy technique. And sometimes rosewood guitars feel a little bit, they're warm in this kind of compressed way. Right? If I want it to sound ugly, it won't sound ugly enough, you know? That's an important thing for me. This guitar, as I understand it, I forget. forget the name of the previous owner, but it was all the sides were held. There were these big holes in it, and they had duct tape underneath them. And everything was kind of caving in for a long time. And then it got in the hands of T.J. Thompson and Ken Fallon, and it's kind of what it is today. I was going to show you just because there are these four chords that I like to play on guitars as kind of a just to suss out where the overtones are. You might get a kick out of it. They're really, really, really simple, but they're kind of unusual. This guitar, I think, does it well. Tell a lot about a guitar.
Well, what shall it be?
What shall we close with?
Anybody?
I'm not gonna know anything.
Steady proof.
But I thought.
All right.
I had my mind.
Do another one of ours. Thanks for coming again. This has been awesome. Thank you, Rufo, for having us out here. Wintergrass, Patrice, I don't know if you're here. Thank all of you. Chris Seldred, guys. Julian Lodge.